to stop the lecture a little early, maybe around 12 o'clock, in order to have a little time to answer any questions you might have or to have a little discussion on some of those basic issues that were in that reading assignment for last week, my little booklet called Architecture, Some Basics, that dealt with different structural systems, forces in architecture, and different kinds of architectural drawings. So for those of you who just understand all that material completely and it's just old hat, you don't need to stay around when I end the class early. But for any of you who would like to discuss some of those issues or had some questions, maybe something you didn't understand about that reading, we'll just have a kind of free-for-all discussion about that. Okay, let's have the first couple of slides. Last time we were looking at the beginnings of colonial architecture in America. The Spanish colonists, Dutch, other groups, and we saw on the left there the Palace of Governors of the Spanish settlers from Mexico in what's now New Mexico in Santa Fe from the early 17th century. And then we began to look at the English colonies, first in New England. And on the right, I remind you of the Parson Capon House in the small town of Massachusetts, built in the 1680s. And we saw that it was essentially a medieval type of English house from English rural areas or small towns, made out of a heavy timber structure, and we saw that diagram of the heavy structure with the beams and posts pegged together, but then covered with a surface of boards, as you see here, clapboards as they're called, to retain the heat better, a feature which was not generally done or often done in the English houses, in which the structure, the underlying structure, was often left exposed. And this retention of heat was seen to be a kind of obsession with these colonists in New England. And we see, for example, that even from the outside, you can get some idea of how the interior plan is. You remember we saw the floor plan, and the chimney is right in the center. The fireplace is open into the rooms around it, again, so that it's kept in the center for heat retention. But we saw that there were some other aspects that couldn't be explained in this clearly objective or materialistic way, including this overhang. The upper floor is hanging over with these little pendant decorations from them, and we looked at the detail of this from another house in Connecticut that I just happened to have a slide on here, we see that, and saw that this was a vestige of a European urban pattern of building houses over the street, and not to save space, which obviously was not needed in these expanses of New England. And so this was a device that was very early dropped from the colonial construction patterns in New England. Let's look at one other of these early New England houses. This one's called the Fairbanks House in Dedham, Massachusetts, close to Boston. And the original part of this house, you can almost tell from looking at this that it was built in stages and was added onto. But the earliest part, which is right in the center there, I guess this part here, even without that shed roof that comes down on the side, that kind of salt box form as we saw. But that the original part apparently was built in 1636, and they've advertised that on the chimney there, I think. And it's actually one of the earliest of these New England houses. Other parts were added later, and you can see, especially with these parts down here, it makes it as if the whole house is roof. It's all roof. And again, I think mainly to conserve heat, just to create this envelope and covering as much area with the smallest surface area outside. It's almost kind of like a mathematical calculation of the best way to preserve heat. And as a result, it produced a form which I think is unlike anything that one would have found in England at the time, or certainly not commonly found, this type of housework. Everything, almost everything is roof. And so already we could say that there's a new American form or new types of architecture that are being created in response to local conditions in the colonies. I have some other views or diagrams of this Fairbanks house that I think are interesting to show. This is a drawing, a diagram that's from that book that I think I mentioned last time. It's a book by Abbott Cummings on colonial construction in New England. And it's on reserve, I believe, is the looking assignment for this week, just for you to look at the illustrations. And this is one of the reasons I put it on reserve for you to look at, because besides photographs of some of these houses, there are some very good drawings, very interesting, including this one, in which Cummings or some other scholar of this period has attempted to reconstruct stages in which the house was built, at least the original central part of it, and to try to figure out exactly how it was constructed piece by piece, how these posts and beams were put together. And as we can see, according to this reconstruction, some of the parts were done in pieces on the ground, probably, and then lifted up into place and then pegged together. It was a highly kind of labor-intensive type of construction, but it's a type of construction that was and clearly took a lot of forethought to figure out exactly how these pieces were going to fit together, and then when they would fit into place, how they would be pegged together, and the mortise and tenons would have to fit together. And you can see how detailed some of these connections are, if you can see that detail that closely. But this is a type of construction, this idea of building with these heavy timbers and then lifting parts of the building into place, that was not just found in colonial New England, but it continued for a long time in America as a tradition. And we know it in more recent times, or at least in the 19th century. It's been documented, even with photographs, in the 19th and early 20th century, as what is sometimes called barn raisings. And here's I guess it was on the, I had it on the right. I should have had that with the other slide. Here's this a photograph I found from around 1900 of this barn raising procedure, where we see how this sort of thing might have actually been done. And one thing that it points out is that this type of construction of these heavy timbers that have to be raised up into place requires a joint community effort. It's not something that one person can build a house like this alone. I'm not sure that or the Fairbanks house in Geddon that we were just looking at required this much community effort. It's not quite, it wasn't as large a building, but even so, you can get a sense of what's involved in this sort of construction. And I have another detail from inside the attic or the roof of this Fairbanks house, and you can see some of these large timber members and how they, maybe get a sense of how they're put together. I think we get to see maybe part of some of the pegs here, and you can sense how this has to be slotted into this sort of rafter. These heavy beams that hold together the truss. A truss in architecture simply refers to architectural members, beams, rafters, and others that are formed together to create a stable, usually a stable triangular shape that would hold up a roof in this case. And by having this member tied in and pegged into these rafters, the whole thing takes on strength because of this truss construction. And then on the left is another one of these diagrams from Cummings' book showing how some of the actual parts of this this house were mortised and tenoned and pegged together, as you can see. You can see how complex this structure is. And very different from the later balloon frame construction that developed in the 19th century, which is the way we normally see wooden houses built today, and we'll be looking at that later. And the reasons why the balloon frame system construction did not develop until later is a very interesting one, and that's what we'll be examining in a later lecture. But it's a good thing to keep this earlier type of traditional construction, wood construction, in mind, so that we'll be able to understand better what modern wood construction is, how it differs, and we'll be able to understand the reasons for it. Well, let's look now at one other 17th century New England building. This is not a house. It's the only well-preserved 17th century New England church, or meeting house, as they were generally called in the Puritan sects that built them. This is a church in a small city or town of Hingham, Massachusetts. It's called the Old Ship Church. I'll get back to the name in a minute. Built probably around 1680, is about the same time as the Parson Capon House. When you're trying to remember dates for this material, we're looking at approximate dates are certainly adequate enough, and of course, something like the colonial period, the 17th and 18th centuries, I'd say that maybe remembering early 17th century and late 18th century would be enough here. Certainly you don't need to remember, say, that something was built in 1680, but just in this general kind of way to get a sense, since we see, or will see, there are differences that develop from one part of the century to the other, the earlier 18th century different from the later, and so forth. When we get into the 19th and especially the 20th century, then it's probably best to try to remember things in terms of the decades they're in, because changes really happen by decade. Okay, this Old Ship Church in Hingham, first when we look at the outside of it, there are a couple of things I should point out. Some things have been were added after the original, the early construction of around 1680. One is the steeple, I think, is later. That would not have been there originally. This looks like it was added. Probably also this porch for the entrance. It would have been just a simple square building, but the roof is original. Also, it was probably not painted originally. It was probably just natural wood. It's called the Old Ship Church, and that's a term that developed, I think, in later times, because of the great trusses of the roof. You can see how large these members are, the trusses, the beams and rafters, are all held together with these complex manner. And it was it seemed to people like ship construction. It had the strength of a ship with a great mast, so that's probably where the term came from. And it's just this square shape, completely open inside. They even open up into this truss, so that one sees it all. There's a kind of functional straightforwardness about the whole structure. There's none of the structure is hidden by the roofs. The houses that we looked at, it's part of that English medieval tradition of timber construction, and one can probably find somewhat similar churches or other large structures in England, the provinces in England. One other thing I might just point out, we'll have this slide on the screen, is that you can see the pews don't look like, it doesn't look like the seating in a modern church. There are these boxed areas which normally would actually have been reserved or belonged to individual families. And so this partly had to do with the social organization and the way church membership worked. There was this kind of proprietary aspect of a member in a church community having its own pew. But there's another aspect as well, which is simply, again, this heat retention, this concern, constant concern for heat. These, as you can imagine, a church like this would have been harder and impossible, really, to heat in the winter. They might have had some stoves in there, but it would be cold. And so people, the individual families who had these pews, tried to create a little room that they could keep warmer, and they would bring little stoves and warming utensils of various sorts into these pews, and the walls were partly just to try to keep the heat in those pews. Well, eventually we will look at architecture in New England in the later colonial period, but first let's turn to the southern colonies for a few minutes. The American South, where the conditions were quite different from those in New England, not only in regard to climate, but also the nature of the settlements, with plantations being the norm, plantations producing tobacco, cotton, rice, or other crops, depending on the location and the period. Well, histories of American architecture, when dealing with these southern plantations, tend to focus almost exclusively on the main house. And we will be looking at primarily at the main houses in the colonial southern architecture. And this is done, for one thing, simply because it's these buildings, the main houses, that have survived and are documented, often the only parts of these plantations. But to start with, I'd like to say something, at least briefly, about other plantation buildings, especially the slave quarters, since this agricultural system, of course, depended to a large extent on slave labor, especially starting in the 18th century. And some research has begun to be done recently on the architectural aspect of this part of the story, Southern Plantation. On the left, we see the plans of two plantation estates. These happen to be in Louisiana, I think, and they're later than the colonial period, but they were all I could find. It's, again, this problem of the lack of documentation and of research in this area. It's just very hard to research because there's little evidence that one can find often of the physical and architectural aspects of this these parts of the plantation story. But these plans that I was able to find, that you see over there, of two different plantations in Louisiana, do show a typical pattern of the slave quarters, which, as you can see, I think they're identified here. They're up there. There's the main house, I believe. I'm looking at the slide at an angle. It's a little hard for me to see it. And down here is the slave quarters. You can see there are individual structures often lined up in rows. Well, since these structures were not substantially built, virtually none of them survived, and there's very little documentation that is suggested. But on the right, we see a rare visual representation of slave quarters. This is in an 18th century painting of a plantation in South Carolina. And not surprisingly, since these small structures were normally built by the slaves themselves, they sometimes employed construction methods reflecting African architectural traditions. That's roughly the form, as seen here, of square thatched huts. And this is interesting, of course, but it suggests, I think, a more interesting or a larger question, which is, are there any African traditions of building that may have influenced American architecture in general? That is, not just the slave quarters themselves. Well, recently, a couple of architectural historians have made some suggestions along this line. Most interesting, probably, by a man named John Vlach. Vlach, I'm not sure. It's spelled V-L-A-C-H. I'm not sure how you pronounce it. Anyway, he wrote that brief piece that's one of the readings for this week, included in the reader. Also, he wrote a longer article on the same subject. It was published in a book called Commonplaces, Readings in American Vernacular Architecture, that I listed in the bibliography on the syllabus, in case you wanted to look at that, go into this in a little more detail. By the way, I should point out that vernacular is a term that's used in architectural studies, it's a somewhat vague term, but it's usually used to refer to buildings of a more common nature that are not traditionally thought of as architecture on a high level. It's very hard to make that distinction, actually, and so I'm not sure it's that useful a term. But when you see that word vernacular, it usually means that it's simple buildings that are not part of what traditionally would have been thought of as sort of high-class architecture. Well, let me just mention a couple of John Black's suggestions about this question of whether there may be some elements or aspects of African influence in American architecture. First, he makes a suggestion regarding a type of small house that's found commonly in parts of the American South and is often called a shotgun house, which is a term that's sometimes used for it. And that's, it probably got that term because it's usually two or three or sometimes more rooms that are lined up in a row with the door usually at the front, and you can get a sense of that from this example we're seeing here. Well, Locke has traced this building type, he thinks, that he's been able to trace it, first to Haiti, and he has documented some tradition of this type of house that's built in Haiti. We see two examples up here, looking at them from the narrow end, the front end, where the doors are, in this case two doors in each of these houses. I'm not sure exactly why there are two doors. But you can see the floor plans down here, and you can see how these rooms are lined up, with the porch in the front. Another example found in rural Haiti that would be of a more traditional or older type. And Locke has suggested that ultimately this type of house had its origin in Africa, though it also may have been based on a type of Caribbean Indian dwelling. So that's a very interesting suggestion. More provocative, I think, is another suggestion that Locke has made, which is that the kind of porch that one often finds in Southern architecture, in Southern plantation mansions, extending all the way across the long side of a house, and here as an example, we see Mount Vernon in Virginia, the house of George Washington. Locke has suggested that this type of a porch that runs all along usually the south side of the house may also have had its origin, or partly its origin, in African architecture. And he shows some examples of similar types of porches in Nigeria, in different parts of Africa. And here we see this is from an example from Nigeria. Now in this case, the evidence is not as clear. And the story is complicated by the fact that porches like this are found in many parts of the world with hot climates and are a natural response, really, to climatic conditions, to create a shaded area on the south side of the building. But still, it's a very attractive idea. One wants to believe it, I think, at least I would like to. It would be such a wonderful irony, of course, if the most distinctive form of the southern plantation mansion actually had its source in Africa. But like much in the history of vernacular architecture, the documentation on this is scanty, and we probably can't really, at least unless additional evidence is uncovered, probably has to remain speculative. But nevertheless, it's fascinating to speculate on. Well, now I'd like to go back to the 17th century in Virginia and look at some very early examples of plantation houses and pick up the story of the early colonial period in the southern colonies. Now in these early plantation houses, the owners and the builders were generally more affluent and more establishment members of English society than their counterparts in New England. And one result of this was that the buildings in Virginia, from the beginning, tended to reflect more substantial and up-to-date styles of English architecture than the New England buildings. On the left, we see very early one. This is the Adam Thoroughgood House, it's called, in Virginia from the 1630s. So this would be the same time as that Fairbanks house we saw in Devon, Massachusetts, the one that was almost all roof. This house on the left is one of the earliest surviving Virginia houses, but as you can see, it's made of brick, which was, the buildings we saw in New England were not brick, they were wood, and brick was not used in New England until later. So this would be another example of somewhat more substantial or more lavish construction types being used in Virginia. Roth talks about this house, as I remember, and describes it as combining several traditions of English vernacular architecture, but they are also simplified as to be barely discernible, and so I decided not to try to go into this and explain this. One thing, though, that I might point out about this house is interesting, is that if you look at the chimney, or in fact there are two chimneys here, they're on the ends of the house, not in the center, and I think, so there's a difference with New England. Heat retention is clearly not as great a problem in Virginia. But the house on the right more fully reflects English fashion. This is called the Allen House in Surrey County, Virginia, but the name that it's usually known by is Bacon's Castle, and I think maybe that's the way I listed it on the handout for this week. I don't know where that name Bacon's Castle came from. Maybe if it's a name that goes way back to the colonial period, it might be the fact that it's a much more lavish and just a more substantial house than others in the colonies, and people may have thought that it looked like a castle. It was so big. In any case, this was built in the 1650s and would have been one of the largest houses in probably the colonies at this time. It was built by a wealthy planter, this man Allen. And just look at one more view of it from the other side, from actually what was originally the front or the entrance side. And here, first of all, I should point out what you can probably see here clearly, that there have been changes made in the house. Probably this was a doorway originally, if you can get a sense of that. This was probably a door that then the interior plan of the house was changed. This may have been some kind of a porch that perhaps added later, then taken off. And this looks like something that's happened up here, whether this roof went up with the gable being brick, I'm not sure. But I point this out as, in a sense, to remind us, we have to keep in mind, with any old buildings that we're looking at, we have to keep in mind that there may have been changes, and maybe not as obvious as we see here. So houses have this long history, and we aren't necessarily looking at the house in its original condition. But more to the point, or more relevant to our discussion here, is that this house has certain details that reflect things that were the latest, or more almost latest, up-to-date fashion in England at this time, in contrast to the New England buildings, which were drawing on more medieval and older traditions. And what's being reflected here are aspects, very simplified aspects, of what in England was called the Jacobean style. Now, I don't we'll be talking about various things from Europe, different styles, and there's no need to get into them in great detail, but it is important to have some sense of what these ideas or styles were that were being brought to America. So let's look at an example of a Jacobean house in England. This obviously is a grand, very important castle, palace, but it was just the best slide I could find, even though it's a little hard to see the details. Happened to be the best slide I could find of a Jacobean house that whose forms are reflected to some extent in this house in New England. This was a style that was, the word Jacobean actually doesn't really say too much about the style. It simply refers to a period in England. It's the period when King James was reigning, and it usually refers to James I, who reigned at the beginning of the 17th century. That was then James II later, but it's usually referred to this early 17th century period in English architecture. And it's a style that combines certain medieval characteristics, but with some things that are beginning to be more Renaissance, but with rather playful decorative devices, especially often found in the roof forms, curving roof forms. Part of this comes out of Flemish architecture.
Decorative chimneys, and a lot of this you can see here, especially the chimneys, the way this is divided up into three parts, the chimney up here, and then they're turned at angles and tied together up at the top of the wood down here. It creates these decorative patterns and silhouettes that one finds in the English Jacobean style. I don't know if you can see that, but there's a very close example of that there. And then the roof line here with this this outline that, again, you can see is a somewhat simplified version of that. So clearly, this whoever designed this house, we don't know in this case whether it wouldn't have had an architect in the modern sense. It might have been designed by the owner himself, who perhaps knew something, knew buildings like that in England, or had seen them, or had seen pictures of them. So, but it's drawing on more recent styles of English architecture. Let's look at another one of these early Virginia buildings, which is quite as interesting as Bacon's castle, but in a very different way. This is a church, a southern church. We've already seen the old ship church in Hingham, Massachusetts. This is St. Luke's Church in Smithfield, Virginia, that apparently was built in the 1630s. It used to be thought that it was from the late 17th century, but they actually discovered some evidence of an inscription that they hadn't seen before on the church that seems to indicate that it was built in 1632. And if this is true, it would make it perhaps the oldest church building in the United States. More significant, however, than the actual age is the character of the building. It was a more or less up-to-date representative of a certain type of parish church in England at the time. And England, at the beginning of the 17th century, had still not fully felt the effects of the Renaissance in architecture, at least not in most rural architecture. English church architecture was, for the most part, still essentially Gothic in style. And here we see that in this church, we actually have some same features that show that it's part of the Gothic tradition, even though they're very simplified. But the windows here have slightly pointed arches, and I think maybe we can see this better in another view. Here's a view of the from the end of the church, and this pattern of the windows with these pointed arches, and then the way they intersect comes right out of a tradition of English, late English, Gothic church architecture. And there are buttresses on the side of the church, which are also part of that medieval church building tradition. Now, what's interesting about this is, or one of the things that's interesting, is that later in America, the Gothic style, as we'll see in a later lecture, was to enjoy great popularity, and this is in the 19th century that the Gothic style becomes very important, but as a revival style. Here, however, we have a building which is not Gothic revival, but actually part of that original medieval Gothic tradition. It was being built in this church was built this way in the 1630s, not because they were trying to revive something old and make it look ancient, but because that's simply the way they churches they knew from their provincial English towns. So, in that sense, we might say that it's the only real piece of Gothic architecture in America. And as such, it symbolizes nicely the overall medieval character of most of the English colonial architecture of the 17th century, both in New England and Virginia. Let me just show one other view of this. This is the interior of this church. Again, I'm not sure exactly how well this has been preserved, whether this is exactly the way it looked originally. But in general, I think it probably does reflect the original character, and for example, in the structure of the roof, again, a kind of truss structure. It's again exposed, a bit like that old ship church in Massachusetts, but this is a more sophisticated design. You can see that this is more up to date and done in a more sophisticated manner. Well, when we move on to the 18th century, we find a very different picture from what we've been looking at. Even though styles, of course, don't change automatically when a new century occurs. Still, there were important changes in American architecture roughly around 1700. So we really can, it does make some sense to think of the 17th century English colonies as having a certain character and then something else in the 18th century. Well, to some extent, this change has reflected economic and social changes in the colonies. By the 18th century, they were no longer small, isolated settlements segregated by sharp religious and other differences. The English colonies were becoming more homogeneous, more intercourse between them. As there was increased immigration and prosperity, more communication and trade between the colonies, and in general, a more urbane population. Now, when I use the urbane, I'm really thinking of it in the literal sense of the word, of having to do with cities, because the 18th century saw the development of real cities. Actually, what we would probably call towns, but as close as they got, even in Europe, they would have been called cities, probably. Saw the development of real cities in the English colonies, even in the south, where there had been virtually no towns in the 17th century, just these isolated plantations. And before getting into the architecture of the 18th century, let me show two or three of the plans of these 18th century American cities or towns, which also reveal a great deal of diversity, representing several basic different types or concepts for planning a town, which and types which are still found in American cities. You might say that these early patterns that one finds in the colonial period of town planning kind of set patterns which one still finds in American cities. Let's look at, first on the left, look at Boston. This is a map of Boston in 1728, so it's during this period we're talking about, the early 18th century. If any of you are familiar with Boston, you may be puzzled and are not, but don't know the history of Boston and haven't seen this early plan before. You may not even know what you're looking at, because it doesn't look anything like modern Boston as far as the overall shape of the city. It was on a peninsula originally, connected to the mainland by a very narrow isthmus there. Boston today, this is Boston Harbor all around on this side, and the Charles River that came down here. And much of what we're looking at now, the bay, Boston Harbor, has and the Charles River has been filled in. It was filled in the 18th and 19th centuries. But this is, if you do know Boston, this is the Boston Common up here. Beacon Hill was here. Now it's all filled in here. Back Bay is over there. This has all been filled in. This is the north end. But the point I wanted to make here was that this is a type of a town plan that one finds in some of the older colonial American cities, which was simply, one might call it organic. It simply grew this way. It started out as a settlement down here originally, and some streets were built linking to the shore where the ships would come in. And then other streets were added, and some of them were based on cow paths and the Indian paths and so forth. And it just grew in this kind of, evolved in this organic sort of way. It could be called medieval in this. And there's like small English medieval towns that didn't really need to be planned. They just grew over the centuries. And of course, later, this was to create problems in a town like Boston. As the city was expanded, the bays were filled in, and it became a large city. This street pattern was a nightmare, because with all these tiny little twisty streets, it became almost impossible. And in fact, much of downtown Boston still has vestiges of this street pattern, and clearly is not a logical type of city plan for a city that's going to become large. It makes sense maybe to build a town. So, however, we look at another colonial American city, we see something completely different. Here's Philadelphia. Now, this is not, it doesn't go back as far as Boston. It wasn't laid out in the, begun in the early 17th century. It dates from the late 17th century, from 1682, when the plan was laid out by William Penn himself, the founder of the colony, who had much more of far-sighted and ambitious plans for the city. And so laid it out with this plan that at the time, of course, would not all have been occupied. Only a few blocks probably would have been needed for the actual population at the end of the 17th century. But this is looking to the future, having this vision that there might at some time be a great city here. And so it's laid out in this very logical way, in this grid pattern, going all the way from the two rivers on either side, the Delaware River, I believe, over here, and the Schuylkill River on the left, and creating this this grid pattern, which was a type of plan, which it wasn't completely invented by William Penn. It had a tradition in Europe that went back actually to the Renaissance and even earlier back to Roman and Greek times, and had in European town planning was associated primarily with colonies. When the ancient Greeks, for example, would establish a new colony in Asia Minor, say, they would often use this plan, this grid plan, because it was a logical way to plan a town from scratch, if you were thinking in a premeditated way about it. So it became a tradition for colonial plans, and America obviously provided a fine example of that. Land is divided up into these squares, and there actually were some public spaces also planned, a large square in the center, and then four parks, which still exist in Philadelphia. And so it's this very forward-looking, more rational way of planning, and became very common in American city planning. At the same time, that one finds examples of the organic Boston type of plan also. So one might say that these are the two extremes on a kind of spectrum of different types of city planning. Let me show one other example of a colonial American city plan, which I guess would be more in the tradition of this premeditated grid plan, but it's different. It's kind of variation of it. And this is the plan for Williamsburg, Virginia. It was laid out in 1699, right at the end of the 17th century, by a man named Francis Nicholson, who was actually the colonial governor of Virginia. And he laid it out as the new capital of the colony of Virginia. It had previously been in Jamestown. And so he picked a site and planned the new capital from scratch. And we see here a model, of course, of the town. You can probably tell us the model, and it's a model of the original colonial town as laid out by Williamson and by Nicholson, and then as it developed the buildings in the colonial period. Nicholson had believed that Williamsburg would develop into a major city, and partly that may explain the kind of the grandiose or careful planning he did for it. It never did, really. It stayed a relatively small town. But the plan reflects this ambitiousness that he had, and it's drawing on more up-to-date principles of planning from Europe, where, for example, there is a strong axis that the whole town is organized around, and here is this main street, the Duke of Gloucester Street, as it was named, and focal points are very important in this type of planning. There was a more up-to-date type of European planning. So that that there are actually two main axes, the main one, Duke of Gloucester Street, and then a secondary axis, which is a street that runs down here, and then there's a large green space, a kind of common, and at the ends of these three axes, here at the end of the Duke of Gloucester Street at the two ends, and then at the end of this secondary axis, are the main public buildings that act as focal points for this whole enterprise. The Capitol building down here, where the colonial government met, and the college of William and Mary up at the other end. A college was actually planned right from the beginning, and we'll be looking later, I think, next on Thursday, I'll look at Colonial American College planning, and we'll actually see the building of William and Mary. And at the end of this other axis, the governor's palace, the governor being, of course, the main figure, the representative of the king during the colonial period. And let's see, I think I have a couple views of the town. Here's the Duke of Gloucester Street. You can see that it has never really grew into a major city. It still has a small town character. The Capitol building at this end down here, and at the end of the other axis, the governor's palace. There we do that with this large green space. So there's a planning for large public spaces, focal points for these axes, and it's a grander type of planning. So I say we'll look at we'll come back to Williamsburg in another context later. Well, in the remaining time before I cut off the class early today, I'd like to begin to look at architecture in the 18th century English colonies. This too, like the city plans, has a great deal of diversity. But there's perhaps one overall generalization that we can make about 18th century English colonial architecture, which is that it's nearly all related in some way to the classical tradition, in contrast to the more medieval character of much of the architecture of the 17th century colonies. Well, what do I mean by classical? This is probably a good time to say something about classical, since it's a term that all comes up inevitably in talking about architecture and for the rest of the order. In one way or another, there are likely to be references to classical. Well, the word classical can have lots of different meanings, but from an architectural point of view, or specifically the way we're talking about it, our context here, it refers to the tradition of architecture that goes back to Greece and Rome originally, and then was revived in the Renaissance in Europe. And it uses certain basic architectural elements that are sometimes called, or might be called, the classical vocabulary. Let's look at a couple of actual classical buildings, one from antiquity, a Roman temple. This is a Roman temple in southern France. And another classical building is from the Renaissance, when classicism was revived in a very conscious way in Italy in the 15th and 16th centuries. And this is a church in Florence from the early period of the Renaissance. So that we can talk about what these classical elements are. Well, classicism on a very basic level uses certain basic or fundamental features that create this vocabulary, we might say, of classicism. Probably the most basic elements are columns with their supporting beams above. If we're thinking in this structural sense of column and beam construction, there are the columns and the spanning beam, which in the classical language is called an entablature. That's one of the terms for that. The columns themselves are made up of the shaft and capitals. This is the column capital. And the column capitals can come in various forms. The main forms are three basic forms: Doric, Ionic, and Corinthian. This is the Corinthian capital, the more most complex of the three. They create the orders in architecture, as they're called. And the whole concept of the orders in architecture, in classical architecture, is important to understand if we really were studying classicism in detail. These different orders, the Doric, Ionic, and Corinthian, not only determine the type of the capital, but also other elements of the architecture, such as what how the entablature is designed, whether there's a frieze above, and so forth. And so it's a systematic. I think that rather than understanding or getting into all of the details, one underlying concept that's important to remember about classical European architecture is that it's highly formulated. at least in its pure form, it follows certain rules. If you're going to have a Doric temple, it determines certain things about the design. Not everything. There certainly can be variations of various sorts, but it determines proportions of various sorts, so how thick the columns are, not only what the capital is like, but what how the entablature is carved. And so it's a systematic kind of a system, and it could be called a classical system. But there are other elements that the Romans added to classical architecture, primarily arches. And we see these in this Renaissance building. Arches and domes were a Roman addition to the classical vocabulary. And here we can see them combined with the columns in a way that the Greeks would never have done. So there are different types of classicism, and it changed as it moved through history from the Greeks to the Romans to the Renaissance. And it's and there are many different versions of classicism, but they all are based on these essential elements: columns, capitals, entablatures, and variations of some of these things, and arches, including, if you look over here and if you can see what's happening on this wall, or over here maybe you can see it a little better, this is like a column, but it's flattened out and placed against a wall. And this is called a pilaster, spelled P-I-L-A-S-T-E-R. So it's another element in this classical vocabulary, a kind of variety or variant of a column. And there are lots of other aspects and variations of the classical system. And it was used in a great variety of ways, as I've suggested, over the centuries, especially in the 17th century, what's called the Baroque period, a period of great architectural innovation, but within this classical tradition. And we don't need to go into this in any detail, but I do want to show a couple of examples of English Baroque architecture, because they have, this is the period, of course, that the American colonies are drawing on English architecture. So it's good to be helpful to look at a couple of really high style, up to date, the latest fashion in European architecture in the 17th and 18th century. You don't need to remember the names of these things we look at in England or Europe. This is just to get across in the sense of the general concept. Now, around 1700, English architecture was dominated by the influence of the architect Christopher Wren. And here on the left, we see one of his great buildings. This is the Cathedral of St. Paul's in London, built in the 1660s, or starting in the 1660s after the Great Fire of London, which destroyed a lot of this center of the city of London. And in St. Paul's here, we see Wren combining the classical elements in various ways. This is typical of Baroque principles. All of the basic elements, or most of the basic parts, are classical. We see columns here with their capitals, and you can see those, and tablatures, a pediment. I forgot to point out that another aspect of the classical vocabulary is the triangular gable that's over a porch like this, or at the end of a building, and that's called a pediment. So it's got all of these basic classical elements, but they're combined in ways that are imaginative and new, doubling the columns, putting one pediment over another, and especially in these towers here, doing all sorts of odd things if we look at details, such as turning the columns at an angle. Angles become important. Curves and angles are important in Baroque architecture. So it's a loosening up and bringing in all sorts of innovative ideas. We see that even more in the example on the right, which is, we see here two drawings of a floor plan and then a perspective drawing up at the top of a palace, the greatest palace that was built in England during this period. Not for the kings, however. It was built for the Duke of Marlborough, an interesting story behind it. But it was designed by an architect named John Vanbrugh, who was perhaps the most Baroque English architect. And Blenheim Palace is what it's called, built around 1700. And again, if we had the time to look at this in detail, we'd see that all the parts, again, go back at least to classical elements, but combined in all sorts of imaginative ways, including in the floor plan itself, or if we look at the overall view here. things arranged in a complex pattern with a central axis and a focal point, the main building, and then these subsidiary parts connected with wings, and curves become an important part of this, and this complex organization building up to a central focus. All of these are aspects of the Baroque style in a full-fledged kind of way. Now, this full-fledged Baroque did not have much influence in America, understandably, since it was an architecture largely of the royalty and the court, and the upper class, and the aristocracy. But there are some touches of its influence that one can find in the columns. Let me just look quickly at a couple of examples. Here we see a house called Stratford in Virginia, Westmoreland County, Virginia. It was the home of the Lee family, one of the wealthy landowners in Northern Virginia. It was built in the 1720s. And we see that the overall organization of the house has something of this character of Baroque complexity. The house is divided into parts. It's not just one simple structure like all the earlier colonial American buildings we've seen. It's divided into three parts, which suggest an axis that runs through the house this way. And then there are these chimneys, which have this much more monumental form than is really necessary. And in fact, they're similar to some chimneys that are in the... I forgot to show the slide. Another view of Blenheim Palace. Here it is. You actually see the front of Blenheim Palace, and you can see this this complex organization, some of these things we pointed out. And if you look at these towers over here, it's almost as though these chimneys are aping that. And if you look at the side of Stratford, we see again a kind of axial organization, and this the stairway leading up to the door, much more lavish and complex than it needs to be, just to get from the ground up to the front door. In fact, it's a type of stair that in European architecture of the period was associated mainly with palaces, a type of stair that divided and went up in two different ways. It had to do with processions in European aristocracy. The actual name for it is the imperial stair. And so what's really suggested here is that the colonial upper class in Virginia here is trying to appropriate the forms of European nobility. We clearly see this psychological element which is affecting the architecture here. Let's just look at one other detail of this house in Stratford, which is the brickwork of the lower part of the house. You can see this is interesting too, that the whole house is made of brick, but the lower floor, the basement floor, is a different pattern of brick from the upper. So there's this variation that's being created. All of these aspects, which don't really only have to do with style, there's nothing practical anymore. There's no practical reasons for these. The brick itself is laid in a pattern, or what's called bond in brick laying. Bricks can be laid in different ways. They can either all be the long side of the bricks can all be exposed on the surface, or they can be alternated. So you see the long side and the short side, and that's called Flemish bond. There are different names for all these different types of ways of laying brick. Here, this an up-to-date type, this Flemish bond, is being used in this house, and furthermore, a different type of brick is used, so that when the end is shown, it's a glazed brick that has a different color, so to give that kind of, give an interesting pattern. So you can see that this is a very different, we're at a different level of architecture, of the pretentiousness, one might say, of this architecture from the 17th century. Well, maybe this would be a good time, actually, to break off. We'll pick up with this story on Thursday, and I will, let's raise the lights a bit. Those of you who want to leave can leave now. Those of you who would like to discuss some of those basic elements of architecture that were in the reading selection that pamphlet, Architecture Some Basics, having to do with different structures in architecture and different architectural drawing, are welcome to stay. We'll have some
If I have questions, I'm going to call you later.
Or would you just like to discuss some of these points? As you remember, the First, there is a section on architectural structure, the different forces in architecture, how they work, different types of different structural systems, something about the materials, how they relate to the structural systems, and then that's the section on architectural drawings. So, first, were there any questions about any of that? Yes?
I didn't really understand the concept of the picture point.
Yeah, okay, well, maybe a way to do this would be first to talk about the structural aspects, since that came first, and then we'll get into the drawing. Because the point you raise, I understand, I know it's a little complicated, but it's also kind of a detail that really isn't that important to remember. So, to start with, at least, maybe let's first think about structural systems, and maybe a good way to start would be for me to throw out a basic question. What are they, remember I talk in this pamphlet about the different forces in architecture. What are the two basic forces that architecture has to deal with? Okay, compression and tension, right? Speak loudly so that we all can hear. It's a little trouble sometimes here. So tension and compression, and do you all understand the difference between these? This is very basic, but it's important to understand the difference. Compression is when you push on something. We have a pointer that I don't use anymore since I have the light pointer. If you think of this as a column or some kind of an architectural member, if you just hold it like this and press down on it, that's compression, trying to press it together. On the other hand, if you grab it and try to pull it apart, that's tension. So those are the basic basic forces in architecture. There are variations of them, and there are other forces like twisting forces. But from a very basic point of view, those are the main ones. Let's think now of different structural systems which may or may not use different of these forces. Why don't you name a structural system? Post and lintel, I think I heard you say. That's right, okay. The term structural systems really refers to basic ways that these forces in architecture can be met with and can be resolved, or that something can be built taking those forces into account. And probably the most basic structural system is called the post and lintel system, which is where you have a post or a column, several of them, and then you put a lintel over the top to span. And this is the post, this is the lintel, or the column and the beam. There's two different ways it can be described. The other term that sometimes is used for the system is the tradiated system, which is just another word for the same thing, just different terms. So in the column and beam system, the column, what force is working, or what force is involved in the column? Compression, almost completely compression. Sometimes there may be a little tension if they're twisting, things are going on, or wind or something like that. But for the most part, the weight of the lintel plus the weight of the column itself is simply bearing down, and so there's compression, it's in compression. What about the lintel? What forces do you think are working in the lintel? Okay, there is some tension. Is there also some compression?
Yes.
Yeah, there's both. And without, you can go back and read this section of that pamphlet if you want in more detail. But basically, there's both tension and compression at work in a lintel like this. There's tension at the lower part of this part of the beam where it spans. Compression at the top, and then it changes here, and it's actually a rather complex pattern in any lintel of compression and tension. What are the name of another structural system? Besides the public.
Truss.
Okay, a truss, that's right, is actually the more complex system where you've got members, like steel maybe, or iron members, that make a pattern like this. You find, for example, in a truss bridge. And so that's a different way of dealing with these forces, maybe of spanning a distance, for example, to create a bridge. And the forces that are involved in a truss are even more complex than this. You've got, if you're going to do a structural analysis of this, you find that each one of these members in a truss may have a different pattern of tension and of tension and compression. So the forces get complex here, but it's a different structural system that's dealing with the problem of, say, spanning a distance in architecture. It deals with it in a basically different way from column and beam. Let's name some other structural systems. An arch, okay. That's a completely different way of solving the architectural problem of, say, spanning, roofing something or being a span. And there, an arch shape is created usually by individual pieces of something, stone, brick, which, because of the way they're formed and the fact that they have basically a wedge shape, are stable and create a stable form that can span a distance. What kind of structural forces involved in an arch?
Compression.
It's completely compression. In a true arch, if it's really built the right way and is not subject to some kind of strange forces like someone trying to tip it over, it's all compression. And that's one of the reasons that an arch is very strong. If it's done in an ideal way, it's completely compression. It's all just forcing down, pressing it all together. There's nothing that's pulling it apart. And what name another structural system. Did you want to ask a question about that?
Yeah. What is keystone? What is sort of like keystone? That top part or something? Why is it so?
Okay, you mentioned keystone. The keystone is a word that's usually used to refer to the top piece up here. Each one of these pieces is technically called a voussoir. That's just the word for each, if this is between their stone wedges. And the keystone is the word for the voussoir at the top. There's nothing particularly special about a keystone. Somehow people tend to think that an arch depends completely on the keystone. The fact is, the keystone is exactly like all the other voussoirs. They're all needed. If you took out any of these, the arch would probably collapse. It's just that in building an arch, this is usually the last one which is put in. How do you build an arch? You can't just start, since the strength depends on it being all there, you can't just start adding the pieces. They'd start falling over. Has anyone ever seen an arch being built?
Yeah,
you need to build something underneath, scaffolding. It's often called centering is the actual word for this, and you build it out of wood or whatever, some kind of a structural framework, and then you have to put these on top, and it's only after it's completely built that you can take the centering and the scaffolding out. What about other, there are two or three other basically different structural systems. Can you think of any? Suspension, yeah, that's a completely different way of dealing with the forces in architecture, where you build piers. Say if you're building a suspension bridge, here's the water down here, and then you suspend cables and maybe additional cables that support a roadbed underneath. So there's a way of spanning a distance. This is the basic architectural problem, one might say, is spanning in a different, completely different way. And the cables, this is the actual structure that's holding up the roadbed or the bridge, involves what forces?
Tension.
Yeah, tension. It's really all tension. So it's the opposite of the arch. The arch is all compression. A suspension bridge is all tension, at least this part. I mean, obviously in the piers, that would be different. There's compression that's forcing them down this way. But the suspension part of it is completely tension. And what does this imply, or what's the implication of this in terms of the materials that we're going to that are going to be used for building any of these things? In other words, are some materials better in tension or compression? And what would be an example of that?
I heard concrete is much more strong in compression than tension.
Well, concrete alone,
oh,
that's
yeah.
right, but reinforced concrete is good in both. But for example, let's think about this bridge. What would you make a suspension bridge out of? Cables made of what? Steel, probably. Steel or iron. First they did it with iron. Steel is even better because steel is very strong in tension. Bridges can be early suspension bridges were actually made out of chains of iron or steel. And you theoretically could make a chain out of stone. But you'd never want to do that because stone is not good in tension. Stone will break. So stone is good for an arch. Stone is good for the column and beam system as long as the span is not very large. That affects the... so there's this kind of relationship between materials and structural systems in architecture. Let's look at some slides. Yeah, for those of you who want to stick around, let's look quickly at some slides. Let's turn the slides on again, just illustrating some of these things we've been talking about. Let's have the next two slides, or I guess I can advance them myself. Oh, wait a minute. Oh, we've got to, there's these other slides I was going to look at. Let's move ahead to where I had that break in the slides. And move ahead to following. That's right. Okay, that's what I want. Okay, here we see an example of the post and beam system, the Parthenon in Greece, where you see the stone being used for the column and the beam, the entablature. And what's interesting here, I think, is that because stone is used, and stone is not particularly good in tension, and for this, the lintel part is partly in tension, it means that the span cannot be very great. That's why these columns are so close to one another. If this were made out of wood, or especially if it were made out of steel, these columns could be much farther apart because both wood and steel are much better in tension than stone is. If these were separated farther and the span was a lot more, there would be much greater chance that it would crack and fail because the tension is low. So there's this intimate relationship between materials and forces in structural systems. Then we get into the arch system developed by the Romans, and there you see a bridge, and you can see the individual blue spars. This would have had to have been built over centering at first. Let's see I'll advance the slides now myself. Here we see this actually being done. Where do you think we are here? Do you recognize this? Yeah, it's the quad being built in the 1880s. Here are the arches for part of the quad, and here's the center. Here's this scaffolding that had been built first. Example of a dome, which is essentially just an arch that's been rotated 360 degrees, the Pantheon in Rome. Now this would seem to violate what I said about arches, which is that the whole arch needs to exist in order for it to be structurally sound, including the keystone, the voussoirs at the top. But here they've been taken out to provide this oculus or opening for light to come into the Pantheon in Rome. How do you think that was done? That seems to violate the idea of an arch.
Why could there be a hole right up at the top? Does anyone have any idea? Actually, it's rather, I hadn't thought about this before, but it's sort of a complex answer. Does anyone have any idea, though?
I don't know, this is a guess, but like if they, maybe there's like a structure a little bit higher than that that finishes the sphere, I guess, the dome.
You mean that there's something else outside? Or?
Yeah. Like
no, that's not the answer. Does anyone else have?
The circle itself provides as like a Another arch.
Yeah, another arch.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Like when you have the pressure coming from the sides.
Yeah, exactly, exactly.
You know, maybe
what's around here, they can take this out because then as long as they made a properly constructed a double arch, we might say, 360 degree with the voussoirs around here that again are pressing in as they're, the rest of the dome is tending to press them into the center, but as long as it's a properly constructed arch, that acts the same way in a horizontal direction. That gets a little complicated conceptually, but that's why I was, that was there something. Then another, some views of a model of the Pantheon, just to give you an idea of what it looks like. And I thought this was a good opportunity to switch to some of the to the different plans. So now, here I've picked some drawings of the Pantheon just to show you it, the different types of architectural drawing, floor plan. And maybe we should hold off on a discussion of these section drawing and elevation drawing of a different building. Probably this is a good time to stop. But would you be interested in having another one of these little discussion sessions after a class where maybe we talk about the different these different drawing types in architecture?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Yep.
Thank you.